the waves, the breeze, the rain, and even in the rustle of the leaves. Hachette Audio presents Indian Sun, The Life and Music of Ravi Shankar, written by Oliver Craske, read by Sohm, Kapila. Introduction, An Unending Quest. Why are you writing about me now? You should wait until I'm gone, otherwise how can you possibly write a fair and unbiased story? Ravi Shankar. In an old Indian parable, a group of blind men who have never before encountered an elephant inspect one using their hands. Each touches a different part of the animal. The man who feels the trunk believes the object is a huge snake. The one who grabs the tail thinks it is a rope. The one who touches a leg thinks it is a tree. In 1966, at the height of what he called the sitar explosion, Ravi Shankar related this story to a London press conference. It was, he explained, the same with Indian classical music. In whichever country it was played, the locals saw resemblances to their own music. Americans said it was like jazz, Japanese compared it to their folk music. But the similarities are very superficial, he said. Beyond that, there is something very deep that is yet to be appreciated by Westerners. Ravi Shankar made it his life's mission to spread understanding and love of Indian classical music. When he took it up himself in the 1920s and 1930s, it was an elite art form that was struggling to survive on the waning patronage of Maharajas and rich landowners. First, he played a leading role in its revival in India as a national classical art form. Then, from the mid-1950s onward, he took it abroad to the world's foremost concert halls, festival stages, and airwaves. He had a rare gift for making new audiences thrill to a previously alien music. It was as if the incense sticks that smouldered during his concerts were slow-burning fuses, setting off chain reactions across the worlds of rock, pop, jazz, folk, and Western classical music. By the end of 1967, it was clear that he was having a global effect. He was Billboard's Artist of the Year, the guru to a Beatle and, alongside his legendary tabla accompanist Ala Raka, the show-stealing sensation of the Monterey Pop Festival. He was in the middle of a six-month run at the top of the classical album charts and had just performed a duet with Yehudi Menuhin in the United Nations General Assembly, East meeting West in a symbolic encounter. Hollywood had commissioned him to write a film score, and a feature documentary was being made about him. John Coltrane had named his son Ravi, the Doors were attending his music school, and Mark Bolan had been inspired to remodel himself. Demand was so high that a dozen Ravi Shankar albums were released that year alone in America. Due to the influence of Shankar, the music of the East is no longer strange to the Occidental ears, proclaimed Billboard. If the mid-1960s passion for all things Indian was only temporary, Ravi Shankar's impact outlasted the craze. Over time, he became a one-man representative of not only a system of music, but an entire culture. As an icon of India, he ranks not far below Gandhi or the Taj Mahal. At one stage, there were three Indian restaurants named after him on Manhattan's Fifth Avenue alone, none with his endorsement. He also lived one of the 20th century's most extraordinary lives. He had an uncanny habit of being an eyewitness to historic events all around the world. He was born in India when the nation was struggling to evict the British, toured Weimar Germany as a child star just as Hitler was rising to power, danced at Carnegie Hall and partied at the Cotton Club, met Clark Gable and Joan Crawford in Hollywood, sang for Gandhi and was blessed by India's great poet Rabindranath Tagore. All this before he was 18. Only then did he switch his focus from dance to music. He came to national recognition at the time of India's independence, toured the Soviet Union at the height of the Cold War, was invited to America in 1956 thanks to the CIA, and moved to California just in time for the Summer of Love. He shone a spotlight on Bangladesh's liberation struggle, played inside the Kremlin in the midst of glasnost, and served as a member of India's parliament. Ravi obviously liked the parable of the blind men and the elephant. In 1974, he deployed it as a metaphor again, this time in a book on India, when he wanted to portray the extraordinary diversity of the country, from the Himalayan glaciers to the tropical backwaters of Kerala, from the turban desert nomads of Rajasthan to the tribal hill peoples of the Northeast. But the metaphor is equally apt for describing public conceptions of Ravi Shankar himself, the sitar maestro, the musical missionary, the counterculture hero, the orchestral pioneer, the traditionalist, the innovator, the soundtrack composer of the Apu trilogy, the godfather of world music, as George Harrison labelled him, or the part sadhu, part playboy, as India Today once called him. He was so multifaceted and long-lived that everyone knows a different part of him, and most have struggled to understand the whole person. This book, the first biography of Ravi Shankar apart from his own, takes on that challenge. I first met and worked with him in 1994 when he was 74. Over the 18 years he had yet to live, I came to know him well and we met on many different occasions. At first I was his editor, but he subtly encouraged me into the role of future biographer, happy to update me regularly on the latest developments in his life. It was easy to like him. He had a rare ability to connect with people of all backgrounds, and I was awestruck by his prodigious musicality. Yet he understood the need for his life story to be told objectively. When Richard Attenborough went to see India's Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, about making a film on Gandhi, the film that, with a soundtrack by Ravi, would triumph at the Oscars 2 decades later, Nehru's advice was that it would be wrong to deify the Mahatma. He was too great a man for that. Ravi Shankar deserves the same approach. Many music lovers find Indian music to be impenetrable on first encounter. 100 years ago, it was little known outside its homeland. On the rare occasions that foreigners encountered it, they would typically describe it as mystifying, monotonous and unending. A maze of noises, as the narrator puts it in E.M. Forster's 1924 novel, A Passage to India. Ravi Shankar would change all that. He knew from his youthful experiences touring the world as a dancer in his brother Uday Shankar's troupe that even sympathetic audiences would need to be eased into the rituals and practices of Indian music. In his early days as an overseas pioneer, he liked to preface his concerts with a short spoken preamble. Seated on a carpet on a raised dais, with agarbatti incense burning and illuminated by gold-hued stage lights, he would first introduce the instruments, typically just 3 of them. There was the tabla, the 2-piece tuned drum played by an accompanist, the tanpura, a simple lute whose open strings are plucked to produce a drone, usually played by a junior musician or disciple, and then there was the sitar, the instrument with which Ravi is synonymous. One early American review described the sitar half-jokingly as that Indian plectrum instrument which Western museum directors love to exhibit because it is one of the most complex-looking machines ever invented by the mind of man. The sitar is a long-necked lute with curved, movable frets, 20 tuning pegs and, in Ravi's model, 19 strings. It is certainly striking in appearance, often beautifully carved and decorated, and when it is played with skill, it seems impossible that one instrument could produce so many different sounds simultaneously, ranging from a thunderous meend on the bass strings to the buzzing brightness of an upper octave melody or the glinting arpeggios of the sympathetic strings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.